Hello everyone, welcome to Advanced Orthopedics Academy. This time we will discuss everything about suprapatellar nailing, including step-by-step surgical technique. Hope it will be useful for young orthopedic surgeon and residents in executing the procedure. We all know extra-articular proximal tibia fracture is a very common fracture that we encounter in our day-to-day practice. It accounts for approximately 10% of all tibial fracture. Although intramedullary nailing is the gold standard for diaphyseal fracture of the tibia, in proximal tibia fracture, sometimes it's very difficult to maintain the reduction with knee bending. With such fractures type, surgeons have struggled a lot with inadequate maintenance of the reduction, suboptimal reaming, and poor placement of the nail, resulting in massive malalignment and further complication. This led Tornetta and Colin to develop a nailing technique which employed in a semi-extended position of the knee. This resulted in minimal apex anterior angulation in all patients. Dean Cole was the first person to advocate a suprapatellar approach using midline quadricep tendon incision. The suprapatellar approach in extra-articular fracture of the proximal tibia helped in minimizing the complications by ensuring that the reduction could be done in an extended or semi-extended position. This prevented the malalignment at the fracture site by minimizing the strong extensor action of the patellar tendon, and this novel procedure has been gaining acceptance in recent days. The primary indication of suprapatellar nailing is probably an extra-articular proximal tibia fracture. Benefits are also obtained in tibia fracture associated with flexion deficit knees, where proper knee flexion may not be possible. Another important indication for this method is a fracture associated with poor skin condition of the infrapatellar region. Less commonly cited indications are patellar baha, ossified patellar tendon, or with additional nerve and blood vessel damage. Further, for patients with vascular and severe soft tissue injuries, pedicle flap or free flap, it may be preferable to nail without much manipulation of the involved extremities. After the introduction of the suprapatellar nail by Tornetta et al. And Colis et al., many others came with good result and substantial advantage than that of the infrapatellar nailing. First of all, the suprapatellar approach does not injure patellar tendon, which is one of the strongest extensor of the knee joint. And this approach avoids the risk of infrapatellar nerve damage, which proved to be one of the major causes of postoperative pain in the form of visual analog score. Studies showed that the surgical time required for suprapatellar nail was also less in comparison to infrapatellar nail. The range of movement of the knee following the surgery was found to be more in the suprapatellar group. Lissome knee score, which describes a validated evaluation of patient activity of daily living, were found to be higher for suprapatellar approach. The fluoroscopic time is significantly decreased in the suprapatellar group due to ease of shooting AP and lateral radiographic view. In case of proximal fracture, easy reduction of the fracture can be achieved in suprapatellar approach as knee bending increases the extension of the proximal fragment, leading to difficult reduction. There was significant increase in the blood loss in the suprapatellar approach in comparison to infrapatellar approach. And rehabilitation, obviously it is faster in the suprapatellar group due to less postoperative pain. As mentioned in the AAOS annual meeting 2016, suprapatellar nail can reduce the incidence of angular deformity to 3.8% as compared to infrapatellar nail, which was found to be as high as 26.1%. So there are some disadvantages of suprapatellar nailing as well, like there may be high chances of damage of intra-articular structures such as cartilage, meniscus, ligaments and other soft tissues. There is an increased incidence of knee joint infection as compared to infrapatellar nailing, and in case of implant removal, it may require a different approach, maybe infrapatellar approach. Coming to the surgical technique proper, here was a 50 years female with proximal 1/3 right tibia fracture planned for suprapatellar nailing after proper and valid consent. Patient was being positioned supine in a radiolucent table with a bolster below the knee to provide a 10 to 20 degree of the flexion. All aseptic precautions was taken and a thigh tourniquet was applied. Boundaries of the patella were marked using skin marking pen. A 3 cm long longitudinal incision ending 1 cm proximal to the superior pole of the patella was made. Quadricep tendon was incised along the length of the skin incision, following which a protective cannula was inserted through the retropatellar space. Entry was made just medial to the lateral tibial eminence in AP view and in line with the anterior cortex and in intramedullary canal in the lateral view. Then guide pin was passed and kept in place. Entry direction could be manipulated using cannulated jig with multiple entry. Entry reamer or awl was passed through the guide pin to and medullary canal was opened to pass the ball tipped guide wire. Sequential reaming was done, holding the fracture in reduced position. So after adequate reaming, an appropriate size nail was inserted, reduction was checked under C-arm and guide wire was then removed. Distal and proximal locking was done as a standard manner, followed by closure of the wound. This was the post-operative radiographs, and we can see the fracture is well reduced with nail in C2. Here I am sharing some useful technical tips and tricks for successful suprapatellar nailing procedure. First, in case of tight knees, it is advisable to release the medial retinaculum to provide easy passage of the sleeve and to avoid iatrogenic damage to the knee joint and patellar cartilage. Second, protective sleeve ideally fixed after getting the appropriate angle of the guide wire. Intraoperatively, displacement of the protective sleeve may result in intraarticular damage. Third, it should be kept in the mind that after reaming, the metal sleeve must be removed, keeping the outer silicon sleeve in place to avoid iatrogenic damage while inserting the tibial nail. And the last but the not the least, after the procedure, one should irrigate the knee joint with sufficient amount of normal saline and wash out all the bone debris present in the joint to get a favorable result. Otherwise, there may be a chance of synovitis. I am thankful everyone of my unit and my team with whom I am working. I appreciate the support of Medtronics India team for this presentation. I hope it will be useful for your practice. Thank you for the attention.